The main item currently on SETI's agenda is to search the nearest stars first for evidence of alien life and civilizations. After all, the closer they are, the easier they are to detect. And while there are some ways to look a bit further out, such as variations in stellar light curves that can only be due to orbiting alien megastructures passing in front of stars, we're still quite limited in what we can distantly see as far as SETI goes. This is not only a limitation placed by the sensitivity of our instruments, but there is also a limitation of time. The further out you look, the further in the past you see how things were in the universe. This isn't too much of an issue with the Milky Way, since it's plenty old enough to have spawned mega-civilizations long ago that we could hypothetically see. But the further you go intergalactically, the less likely you are to see anything. But it's also a similar situation with the nearest galaxies as it is with our galaxy. Some are close enough and old enough for the activities of a civilization to be visible, though they would be very hard to spot unless they started encasing the stars of their galaxy inside full-on Dyson spheres, which we could detect hypothetically in the infrared spectrum. But beyond that, you eventually get so distant in your observations that you're seeing galaxies as they were in the past, that, from your perspective, wouldn't have had time to produce civilizations. Further still, you'd see galaxies that wouldn't have had time to even produce planets when the light we see left them. That doesn't mean they haven't actually produced civilizations, of course. They may currently have them, we just can't see them yet. The information about that possibility can only travel at the speed of light, and simply hasn't had enough time to get here. Check back in 500 million years, and we may know more about further galaxies. But the one area here that hasn't been all that well explored is the notion of a civilization developing outside of a galaxy entirely. The possibility here involves rogue stars. Stars and their associated planetary systems can and do get ejected from galaxies. In fact, a lot of them get ejected. For example, within the Virgo cluster of galaxies, it's estimated that 10% of the stars originating in those galaxies have been ejected. Billions of rogue stars in that group alone. This is thought to happen in several ways, from chaotic galaxy mergers to stars from near a galactic core getting ejected by a supermassive black hole. Needless to say, a significant amount of the stars in this universe exist outside of galaxies. While many of these stars would be unsuitable for civilizations to arise, it is hypothetically possible. This situation creates both advantages and disadvantages to civilizations that may arise in ejected rogue systems. One advantage is temperature, and a lack of things like gamma ray bursts and nearby supernovas that pose threats to life within galaxies. In fact, entire sections of galaxies are probably uninhabitable. Like star systems, galaxies have their own type of habitable zone, where within a galactic core, life and civilizations might not arise simply because the stars are too closely packed together and blasting each other with radiation, frequent supernovas, and presenting all sorts of seemingly impossible challenges for life. But as you move outward from a galactic core, you find places like here, where conditions do allow for life, as we are evidence of. And that brings us to the disadvantage. The further out you go in a galaxy, the less raw materials your civilization has to work with. And when you leave a galaxy entirely, you have far less than that. So a civilization arising in between galaxies would be presented immediately with a long-term resource problem. This may keep them from ever leaving a Type 1 stage of civilization, essentially only being able to make use of their own star system's resources. But even then, that can be quite a lot. If their star system is comparable to our system, we built a civilization on Earth and the Sun's resources. We have yet to tap the rest of the solar system. A civilization could hypothetically go a long way with only the initial ability to colonize its own solar system, but there would be an eventual brick wall. So what else could they do to try to gather resources? As I said, even in intergalactic space, there are still many, many stars. They might be sparser, but if an advanced civilization waited long enough, stars might pass close enough to colonize them. And ideas like building things like Shkadov thrusters, or Fritz Zwicky's idea to use directed solar flares to move stars around, hypothetically can be done if the civilization has the available raw materials to do it. This may make it possible over extremely long periods of time for a civilization to collect stars and arrange them according to their needs. If we ever saw indications of this, an unlikely arrangement of stars within or nearby the Milky Way, that in itself would be a technosignature of a civilization. Just how they might choose to configure their stars is anyone's guess, but if they wanted to get the attention of others, they might configure them very unnaturally, such as making it look like a strand of DNA, or a mathematical counting, or a highly unlikely overall shape. But this would also be a civilization running in slow motion, due to a lack of resources as they constantly run up against the carrying capacities of the star systems they control, so much so that there may not have been enough time elapsed in the universe for such a civilization to have started moving stars around on this scale, and thus, they might not yet exist. But this also brings us to the far future. Will humanity someday move stars? As the Milky Way ages and the old age of the universe begins to see star creation slow and eventually cease, it may be imperative that we do so to collect as much in the way of resources as we can. Collecting up long-lived stars, or even figuring out ways of refueling stars, may become a necessity to keep our civilization going as long as we can. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently making an announcement. Coming soon, some friends and I will...
Hold on, John. The proper way to announce a new channel is to meter it out slowly.
Anna, we discussed this at personality orientation, you butting in during the outro.
And be sure to check out John's book at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to his channel for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which you live.